Wanuri Kahiu, thank you very much for joining us today. I'd like to begin by talking about your film, Rafiki. Kenya obviously still criminalizes homosexuality, and there have been opportunities for Kenya's government to go in the direction of progress, but unfortunately, it hasn't taken those opportunities. Were you shocked that your film was banned?
Hi, it's such a pleasure to be here. So when Rafiki came out and it was banned, I was completely shocked. I was dismayed and incredibly disappointed because I had voted for the Constitution. Like, I lined up on the 4th of August way back when, in 2010, and I voted on a Constitution that allowed me freedom of expression. So to have a film banned when your Constitution says otherwise, it's challenging. So yes, I was very disappointed.
And Wanuri, what is the government's argument here? Because as you say, if the Constitution allows for that freedom of expression, I believe is it Articles 162 and 165 that are often cited in order to for the government to continue with their treatment of members of the LGBT community?
Well, apart from the continuous fight for justice and equality for the LGBT in Kenya, the law that was used to ban the film is the remnant of a colonial law that hasn't changed or been updated since the Constitution came into place. So the problem is that we are working on an old model and it's not reflective of the new Constitution. So they said that the reason that they banned my film is because the classification board said it because the ending wasn't remorseful enough. And if I had changed the ending of the film so that it was more remorseful, then the film would have been rated as 18 and could have been seen. Unfortunately, they decided to go in a different direction, and the film has been banned and remains banned in Kenya at the moment.
Was it ever a question in your mind to opt, instead of the more hopeful ending that Rafiki has, for the, quote, remorseful ending that they would have preferred to have seen? Was it ever a question in your mind to perhaps go along with the more remorseful ending because it perhaps would be one small step forward for the LGBT community, even if it wasn't the iteration which you had hoped and worked for?
I think that if you portray a group of people, especially a minority group of people, as always in despair and always suffering, you're sending a message that of unfairness, and it goes against equality and the ethos that I stand for, which I've begun to call Afro bubblegum, which is a fun, fierce and frivolous view of Africa. It's not a remorseful view of Africa. It's something that is full of joy because we are tired of the negative images that keep on coming from the continent that say that we are a suffering people. We are not a suffering people. And therefore, there was no way I was going to go for a remorseful ending because it goes against my ethos, and my ethos is joyful art coming from the continent.
And Wanuri, tell us a bit more about Afro bubblegum and other misconceptions, other than the fact that the continent is just suffering, that you are trying to help clear up with your art.
Well, Afro bubblegum is the curation and the creation of fun, fierce and frivolous art. It is art for art's sake. It is joyful art. It is art that is full of imagination, because imagination is not a luxury. It is something that is born. It's something that is natural. It's something that is naturally occurring in every single human being. And when we look at the stories coming out of Africa, you will see not only modern artists and modern storytellers telling stories of joy, but there's been a history of joy. But unfortunately, there has been a leaning towards stories of despair and hopelessness that continue to portray an image of a dark continent, of a hopeless continent, of a continent that is in need of saving. I do not believe our continent is in need of saving. I believe that we are fully capable of achieving our own dreams by our own wit and our own imagination. And given the freedom, we will do that. But we also need to have images that remind us that we are worthy of joy And through Afro Bubblegum, our mission is to try and show fun, fierce, and frivolous images of Africa so we can remind ourselves that we have always been a joyful continent, and moving into the future, we do it with joy and hope.
Mm-hmm. Cinema is an incredibly powerful cultural medium, and it can be hugely influential. As somebody who enjoys the creative process of filmmaking and obviously is imaginative and enjoys creating, is it strange to you that you've become an important figure when it comes to potential law change in your country, or does that responsibility sit quite easily with you?
I call myself a reluctant activist, mm-hmm. because I often say that the work that we do as artists in it of itself is a story, mm-hmm. is a message, has everything it needs in it. It doesn't need any further explanation. Mm-hmm. But I think that when the film was banned and I saw the things the classification board was saying about me, about my work, I felt that it was absolutely necessary to start a freedom of expression case, because one, like I said, I believe in our constitution, I believe in the Kenyan constitution, mm-hmm. But also because as a group of artists, being able to create is the way that we live. And so to say to any artist, myself or any other, that you cannot create because your words or what you're saying is so debilitating that an adult voting audience cannot watch it, is problematic to me. And it was problematic as well to the Creative Economy Working Group, mm. which is a collective, a consortium of other artists. Mm. So we banded together and we decided to sue the Kenya Film Classification Board for what we feel was an unconstitutional ban. Mm-hmm.
And Wanuri, I'm not sure how many Kenyans have been able to watch Rafiki because it is banned in the country. Hopefully you might be able to tell me. But what has the response been from people?
Well, what happened is, as part of the court case, mm-hmm. we asked for the ban to be lifted for a week, mm-hmm. which it was. And for a week in September in 2018, the film was watched in Kenya to an audience of over 6,500 people across the country, mm-hmm. to sold out theaters. So Kenyans really, really embraced the film and came out in droves to come and watch the film. And that's the power of storytelling. And also that's the power of a ban. Because whenever you ban something, you inevitably make it more popular. So as a result of the ban, but also because of the story that we were telling, mm-hmm. people came out and found reflections of themselves and were able to start having honest conversations if they were part of the LGBT community as well as a result of the film. So we definitely pushed the needle forward in little ways. And what is remarkable now is, though it's banned in Kenya, it plays on DSTV, which is an African cable station, across the continent, except mm-hmm. for the Republic of Kenya.
Wanuri, you've said rather beautifully that you think the right to love is the most basic human right. Why did you choose this love story? What inspired you?
I wanted to tell a love story because growing up, there weren't many images of us in love, whether it be heteronormative love or whether it was same-sex relationships. There was not many depictions of us in love. Mm-hmm. So when we started the task with myself and my producer, Stephen Markovitz, to find a modern African story that we could adapt to the screen, we landed on a book called Jambula Tree, which was the Kane Prize winner in 2007. And it was such a beautiful story about pure love, and really began to ask questions that I deal with in many different areas of my work, which is inspired by Lucille Clifton poem that asks, what have you traveled towards more than your own safety? Mm. And this story really asked that question. Mm. And as a result, we decided that this was the love story that we wanted to concentrate on, because we believe that love is love. And unfortunately, that wasn't the consensus in the Kenya Film Classification Board. Mm-hmm.
I'd love to get your thoughts on the Oscar nominations this year. And I say this not in any way to limit you, because I imagine it's frustrating to sometimes be referred to as a female filmmaker or a Kenyan filmmaker or an African filmmaker. Yeah. Obviously, you are those things, but you're so much more than those things. What was your response to the Oscar nominations this year in terms of diversity and female representation?
I think that the Oscars still have a ways to go, but in comparison to the films that were released last year, there was a lot more, as far as I could see, because I am lucky enough to be a member of the Academy and I get to vote on the films, mm-hmm. is that what I saw last year is that there was a lot more diversity in the films and the films that were produced last year. So there was more films of people of color to choose from than there was this year. So I think we have a ways to go when it comes to stories of inclusion and lowering barriers of entry so that women and minority groups and people of color have the right to tell stories, and so that they can be seen in front as well as and can participate behind the camera too.
From your experience, what do you think would truly be the most effective ways to continue to address the imbalances, but do it for good and not just in any form of superficial way?
I read a suggestion once that really, really resonated with me about trying to help the imbalance, especially when it comes to gender disparities. Mm-hmm. And it was a mandatory paternal leave for any father who becomes a parent. Mm. And there's a 3-month mandatory paternity leave. And I thought that was a rather quirky and funny way of thinking about the matter. But I think the inclusion, there's many ways, and the Gina Davis Institute has made such strides in the ways forward to be more inclusive of women, and are advocating for studios to be more inclusive of female directors. And I think also a mentorship program between other female filmmakers, like Ava DuVernay has done in the past with her show Queen Sugar, are really great incentives of creating more jobs and creating more ways for women to feel involved in the industry.
Wanuri Kahiu, thank you so much for joining us today. Hugely appreciate your time.
Thank you so much.